Oh, this place brings back some memories. It's 20 odd years ago that I was first in this boathouse. I can remember it like it was yesterday, being dropped off here. There you go, mate. There's the punt, there's the boathouse. Do what you want. And I was left for 2 or 3 days. At the time, the water was tap clear. Like, you know, and can you imagine boating around the lake? I was a lot younger then. I was, what, 26? Just so, so exciting. You know, not even knowing what was in it, just being told there was carp. Just beautiful. Obviously, fished it a fair few times back then. It was quite a sort of regular haunt. Used to come a few times each year. Nowadays, I don't come anywhere near as much. But in a way, I prefer that. It's more of a treat. You know, I love it. So, we had 3 days booked. I don't know if you remember, but a couple of years ago, we had a trip here, the beginning of November, and it went really, really well. So when ESP said, do you want to go and have another go? You can guess what week I chose, the exact same week. So we came, what, 3 or 4 days beforehand, before we intended to fish. Got it for first light, the idea being just to have a little bit of a recce, suss it out, see what the weed situation was like, and put a bit of bait in. And yeah, we got here very first light, half light in fact. And you sort of break through the woodlands, and then you've got a view like down an avenue, a grass avenue, and then the lake's there in front of you. And it was just a classic estate lake morning, you know, really, really misty. The buzzards were calling, the pheasants were running up the path. Everything was just beautiful. Got down here, weed wasn't anywhere near as bad as I thought it might be, so it wasn't so bad. The area that I chose to fish from, like I say, I fished it a couple of years back and had a good hit in November time, so I knew exactly where I was going to be going. You've got a central area out in the middle of the lake, which is pretty deep, goes down to 18 foot in places. And at this time of the year, it's an area the carp really do favour. So I had to choose an angle at that. And the angle I chose, I had to choose an area that was the least weedy, but we still had a little bit of weed close in, probably went up to about 30 foot out from the bank. Well, I'm thinking that we're going to need the punt. And we'll just pull it up here, and that way it gets us out a little bit because of that weed that's growing close in as well. At least I'll be up a little bit higher. So yeah, we'll just clear a little bit for the rods, so the rods will be on the bank. But each time I get a bite, if I'm so lucky, then I just step straight onto the punt and plan from there. I think that's the best bet. I wasn't too sure, you know, am I going to be able to get those fish in from range and then be able to pull them through that last few yards? But then we come up with the idea, we've got a big punt here, it's 20 odd foot long. So we anchored the punt up, nudged into the bank, but facing out, and that got us out almost to the edge of the weed. So it was perfect, like a jetty, if you like. While we were doing that, I actually saw several fish show out in the open water. The old dead's come out. Misty remembers, you've got to imagine it. Shuffle out, bubblers out there. It was just mega. You know, it was pretty obvious they'd get on the bait and there was a good trip on the cards. And so, once the punt was in place, the next step was to get a bit of bait out. Now, rowing a 20 odd foot, 100 year old punt out into the lake on my own to bait up, I didn't really want to be scaring the fish too much, although I wasn't going to be back for 3 or 4 days, you know, like I thought, no, I'll go out in a little dinghy. By comparison, a dinghy's like a leaf on the surface, you know, there's no wake, no disturbance. So I pumped up my little dinghy.
Well, seems like a lot of effort, but rather than using the punt to go out, I want to put a pole out off the side of the island. I'm going to be fishing long, you see, past that island. And it's shallower left and it's deeper right, so it's odds on that any fish hooked will actually kite into the deeper water, so they should go right. But I don't want to take the chance. You know, if one does go left and kites around the islands, then is not good. So I'm going to have a pole there, probably a few feet off the island, depending on the depth. And that way, if one does go left, then my line will be cutting around the side of the pole on a smooth surface on the pole as well. So we should be safe.
Big bag of bait, put out a fair bit of bait. I don't know how much, but it was a lot, probably 15 kilos or something. We wasn't going to be back for a while. And I was taking into account the tench as well. There's quite a lot of tench and rudd and what have you in it. So out I've gone in the dinghy, all the way out into the middle. Of course, the closer I've got as I'm approaching through the mist, you can see the bubblers here and there, you know, like active, like frothy patches, but bubblers that were still active, you know, still going on out there. And they actually carried on even though I was out there in the dinghy. I had the scoop, so a big spread of bait all over the middle area of the lake, over the deep water. Now on the way back, there's an island just to the left of where we anchored the punt. And on the way back, I didn't notice it so much on the way out, but on the way back, I noticed that on the back of the island, there was a bit of a willow. There's always been willows overhanging there, but a bit of it had broken off some years ago and regrown, and it looked a little bit snaggy for my liking. So I had a pole with me, a prodding pole, three sections, screwed them together, had a poke about, and there was actually a bit of weed off the island. So if a fish did kite left from where I was going to be fishing from the punt, then it might not have been so bad anyway. The weed might well have cushioned the line, but I didn't want to risk it. I was out there, I had the pole anyway. So I slid a pole in, poked it into the ground, into the bottom, just out from the island, a few feet, probably 20, 30 foot off the island. And that way, if the fish did kite left, then my line would be running around the pole. In the old days, we used to use this trick at a lot of lakes that we fished over the years, Yateley and whatever, going way back, generally shallower water, you know, and what we do then is you put in a bank stick, a long storm rod or something, and then slide a rod tube 6 foot long. But where I actually poked the pole, it was a little bit too deep for that. And because it's three sections of pole and they've got joins, so what I've done, I actually taped up the joins. The idea being that if the line run round it, it's not going to go in those joins, you know. An awful lot of carp fishing is about thinking ahead. You know, just like putting that pole in place, you know, if I hadn't done it and the fish kite left, it's too late then. So always think ahead. And the same applied for where I actually positioned my rods as well. If there was no weed close in and I had the lines down, now you imagine you've hooked a fish. If it did sort of go through the other lines, I can very easily over the top of the line or underneath the line. But when the line's going across weed, obviously if a fish goes through the other line, I'm stuffed sort of thing, you know, it's going to wipe out that rod. So actually the positioning of the rods, whether I put them on the left of the punt, which we'll call a jetty, that's what we're using it for, whether I put them on the left or whether I put them on the right, I had to figure all that out in my head. And eventually I went for the left. And so everything was set. I actually went fishing somewhere else for a couple of nights, but I've got to be honest with you, all that I was thinking about was this place. I couldn't wait to get back. So it had had the Thursday night, Friday night, Saturday night, it had 4 nights. So I imagined that when I got back, the bait would be well and truly gone. The one hiccup, we had the first frost of the year, and it was a fairly hard frost as well. Everywhere was white when we got here, and I thought, just typical, you know? First frost of the year, why couldn't it have just waited another week? As it happened, it didn't do too much damage. It was actually lovely. Can you guess where I am? There can't be many benches around that are sat on so little that they've got a layer of moss all over them. You guessed it, I'm at the old Oxford Estate Lake. Now the last time I fished here was 2 years ago, this same week 2 years ago as it happens. And it was a real good trip. I had like 18 carp over the space of 2 nights. I'm not so sure it's going to be as good this particular trip. I mean, we've got a bit of a frost, down to like -1, -2 last night. All the grass is white. I don't know, just sat here looking out. I've seen a few roach topping out there. You know, there's odds and ends going on. I baited up from the boat 4 days ago, so it's not like I've not done any prep work. And like I say, there's plenty of signs going on out there. I'm sort of quite confident as it goes. I'm not going to hang around any longer. I want to get my barrow down there, get set up. I'm going to be fishing from further down the bank, just past the little island. Everything's in place already. So, yeah, like I say, I'm keen to get started. So, like, time to crack on. See you in a bit. The area I was fishing was at real long range, like 150, 160, to get to that deeper area of water where I'd baited up. So I sent them out with the old boat. got them all out there. First thing I do once the rods are out and everything was done was to get the old kettle on. And I don't think I drank that first cup of tea before the first rod was away.
Oh.
Come a long way.
I thought we'd got away with it. Typical long range battle, deep water. They always feel twice the size at that sort of range, you know, like big, heavy at that, you know, a lot of line to pick up as well. And it was a bit of a test run, really, you know, like to see how everything went. I knew I'd be fine playing them through that deeper water, getting them back all that range, but it was just that last little bit of weed. But as it turned out, everything went absolutely to plan. It was all perfect. Got it close in, and as long as, by the time I'd got them in at that range, they're pretty much beaten anyway, so I've got them up in the water. I had to plan them a little bit more heavier than what I normally would, you know, once I'd got them close. But yeah, weed wasn't a problem, and I bundled the first one into the net.
Good start.
Common, nice clean fish, 22 pound, tight and bristling like they always are at this time of the year, autumn. So that was the first one in the bag.
Well, first bite of the trip. 22 was it? Forgetting already, but that will do. We'll put you back, and hopefully the bigger ones are out there and all.
So it's only early in the morning, I've already got one, and I don't know how long it took me, probably only another 10 minutes or so. That rod that had had the bite was back out there. Kettle back on, that's the routine. And no time at all later, that fish was shortly followed by another bite, this time on the left rod. I believe, if I remember rightly, the first bite was a bit of a drop back, but the second bite was a tighten up. It just tightened. I was fishing the clutches fairly tight. So it was just like, did-did, as it come out of the clip, and the old tip was just bending, slowly bending over. Classic long range bite. Picked up the old rod again at that range. Could have been a 10 pounder, it still felt like a 30 pounder. No problem all the way back. Pole didn't need to come into effect at that point, but got it all the way back, over the top of the weed, in the net. And this time round, it was my kind of carp, a nice pretty mirror, proper scaly oldie world one. Lovely, lovely carp.
Oh, it's a mirror. Number two. Exactly the sort of carp you'd expect to live in an estate lake, isn't it? And there we are, carp number two. Not quite as big as the other one. This one's a 19 pounder. But what a fish, eh? I'll have a 19 pounder over a 19 pound pretty one over a 22 pound common any day. Not that the common was a bad one, but this one's really, really nice. My kind of carp.
The main reason for adding weight to the bobbins was just because it helps with bite indication at that sort of range, you know. An awful lot of the time when I'm fishing closer, I don't have any problem with it at all, but at that sort of range, dropbacks were highly likely. And so just adding that extra bit of weight, it amplified things, you know? It sort of amplified each bite that I got. If I got a dropback, and bearing in mind the first bite was a dropback, so any future ones, it was gonna help in a big way. I think getting those rods out as quick as I could and making the most of that morning spell, that turned out to be a good move. So it was quite a bright day that day, lots of sunshine. Sort of conditions I could well imagine that the fish were sort of pugged up in the pads and around the island down the far end of the lake, you know, rather than out over the deep water in the middle. It wasn't until, it was probably 4 or 5 o'clock towards evening time, once the old sun dipped below the trees, you know, and then I started to see the first signs again over the deep water, the odd rudd flipping out. Sure enough, no time at all. Left hand rod tightened up. Like I say, fishing fairly tight clutches at that range, but actually took line off the clutch. Same old routine as the previous two. Out there on the punt, punked him in from long range. Hard to tell how big they are when you're playing them in from that sort of range, but I did have a bit of an inkling. I thought, this feels a better one. Got it close in, and as soon as its shoulders broke the surface, and I saw this giant, great big scale on one of its flanks, and I knew exactly what it was. It was a fish that I'd first caught 19 to 20 years ago. Funny enough, while I was filming as well at the time. I'm not normally too keen on the old recaptures, but you know what, with that fish, somehow it was different. 19 to 20 years since I'd first caught him. You just think about everything that you've done in the last 19 to 20 years, you know? Not just the fishing, you know, but everything, your life, everything else that you've done. Dozens of different venues that I've fished, all the adventures. And all the while, that fish was still swimming around, happily doing his own thing.
That's one of the oldies.
It was brilliant, it was good to see him.
Go on, girl. Don't know how old you are. Probably older than me. Back you go. Go on, there you go. Good old girl. Number 3.
The night hours actually turned out to be quieter than I imagined. I heard the odd fish out there, there was a little bit of splashing going on, but I only actually had one bite. But what a fight it turned out to be. You know, it was one of those ones at that range. I hooked it and it was like hooking a sandbag. And it was like that for the first minute or so. Or actually to the point where I was wondering whether it was snagged or maybe weeded up, which I knew just wasn't possible out in that depth, 16, 17 foot. And it wasn't until there was just the odd nod. Imagine the rod compressed right over, just the odd slow nod, telling me it was definitely a carp. And it wasn't until I stepped onto the punt, and as I stepped onto the punt, it actually started to pull away from me. No, nothing like that, not that you'd expect with a 20 pounder, just a dead heavy weight, slowly pulling away. And all I'd done was just walk the full length of the punt. Mega, like, you know. It's funny, but, going back probably 10, 12 years or so, there was a couple of upper 30s in it, you know, so you never know whether any of those are still here. And this fish felt that heavy at that range, I thought, that's it, I've hooked the old estate lake Leviathan, one that hasn't been out in donkey's years, you know. But it turned out to be a good fish, got it in, wasn't until I shone the torch in it in the net that I realised just how special it was. And when I say special, I mean it was like the most gorgeous carp you could ever lay your eyes on.
Look at that for a carp.
No, an absolute perler, covered in scales. know, and it just looked just beautiful, dark, lovely, all golden. The sun even came out for the videoing. It just the most perfect carp, perfect overslung mouth, and a big one as well, just shy of 35 pounds. Second day of the trip was much sort of better conditions. It was cloudier, sort of conditions I'd imagine getting takes through the daytime. But it was still pretty quiet. Only had the one fish that day. Another nice one though, 23 pound common. Rigs wise, I kept things pretty basic. Going all the way back to when I first fished here, it most definitely would have been hinge rigs 99% of the time. Pop-ups, corkball pop-ups on hinge rigs. But you know what, over the last sort of, probably the last few years now, the last 10 years even, I've done a lot more bottom bait fishing, especially with the old flipper rig, you know, where I track the tubing further around on the bend. So that was what I was using. Straightforward bottom baits with a coated braid, tungsten loaded, in the green. I like the old green with the black flecks along it. It's just perfect, blends into the bottom lovely. So simple bottom bait rigs, rotary rigs with the stop positioned a little bit further up the leg core than I normally would, just because it's quite silty out there, like a very soft, irky silt. And on the bait, that was pretty simple as well. Lots and lots of boilies. I had them in three different sizes. I had some 18s, 15s and 10 millers in two different types. I had them in the complex and my faithful old sauce, which I've used for a long, long time now. As well as that, I put in, there was about a jar of tiger nuts. There was a little bag of peanuts that I'd left over from fishing somewhere else, only a pound or so. And then I put in about a pound of the real special stuff, my extra special super salty maize, which they really, really do like. And that's what I tipped my bottom baits with. I was fishing a 15 mil boilie on the hair, but always tipping it off with a piece of that salty maize. You know what, I love carp fishing wherever it is. You know, I've got a boat on the Thames at Twickenham, you know, more of a built up area, you know, but there's none of it can ever be as magical as the real natural world, you know, and this place is just unchanged in all these years, 20 odd years, and it's exactly the same as I remember it from when I was 26 years old. Something really, really nice happened. I mean, you're always seeing foxes and deer and pheasants all over the place, and you can imagine the amount of different waters I've fished over the years. I'm well used to hearing the call of pheasants as they go up to roost in the evening. But this was like probably 2-3 hours into dark. It was deathly silent. And when I say silent, I mean you'd hear a pin drop here at night. It's lovely. And suddenly I've heard the pheasants go off, probably 100 yards behind me, calling. No doubt Mr. Fox snuffling around below him, you know. But what was so good about it was when they went off, then in the distance, probably 100 odd yards in that direction, I heard more pheasants go off. And then 200 yards right over there, more went off. And then 50 yards over there, more went off. And it was all like in a sequence. Because you're in a dip where this lake is, it echoed. It echoed around the whole lake. It was just, it was magical, and that's the only word for it. And it went on for quite a long time. It probably went on for about 10 minutes, you know, back and forth. Probably very, you know, similar to like in the olden days where they'd have the watchtowers, you know, all the smoke signals or something, you know, fox, 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 you know, letting each other know all around the place. It was just brilliant. Similar to the first night, the second night was relatively quiet. But I did have one take, you know, but I picked it up and there was slack. I was really, really willing. And as I tightened into it, I actually felt the fish. Probably not 30 seconds passed before I could feel the line rubbing. And that pole had come into effect. Good job I'd put that pole in place. Little bit of back and forth, and then eventually it was coming clean again. And I could see once I got onto the end of the punt, got up high, and then I could just about make out that the line was going right, and it was back away from the pole. Cleared the other rods. Not a big one. Common carp, how big was it? 22 pounds. But another nice carp. So I slipped him into a sack. But if you've done much sacking a fish, you know, you'll know they only have to be in the sack for a couple of hours and cool, they can be lively when you get them out. And this one was super lively. It proper beat me up as I was putting it. I didn't actually do any shots on the bank or any video footage on the bank. So I was in the water with it and I've just sort of unwrapped it. And as I've got him just lifting it up, water going everywhere like they do. And off he went. I just let him go. Not a bad thing. Sorry about that, mate. I think we got him. Caught a couple of tench, and then finally, tie out the clip, tip bent over proper, definitely a carp. In fact, I've got to be honest, to begin with, it felt just like the 35 pound scaly one did. Really heavy, really, really slow. But then once I got it closer in, it had that lively feel to it. Got it in, it was the smallest one of the trip. But still a nice fish, 18 pound 12. Last fish of the trip, but what a trip it was, you know. Seen some lovely sights, caught a couple of really nice carp, proper old special ones. I did tell you it was a bit of a treat each time I come here now. And hence, here I am now, back at the boathouse, my kit's on the barra. I've now got to make the long drive home. Until next time, cheerio.